All right, we're off and running. I'm feeling great. How about you? And everything's about 99% is great. It's just that 1%. That's have my Apex yoga shirt on here, courtesy of Jimmy. Set this up as far as the design. Apex, and it says Apex Yoga on the bottom of it. Apex yoga shirt. Awesome shirt, man. Just rocking the Apex yoga shirt out here. Day in California, clouding over, some more rain is coming. We had some gorgeous sunshine today, but it's still quite chilly here. So I'm doing great, except for that 1%, which isn't so good, which is, so that's the area, you know, it's like, wow, like, you know, functioning in the world, that 1%, that isn't so good in terms of what to do, how to proceed, how to go forward. Wow, it's a tough one, very tough one right now. It's getting nuts here in the Bay Area. I mean, you're starting to feel the extreme emotionalism is starting to gain steam here in the Bay Area. Not a good thing at all for our practice. Apex yoga. It suddenly dawned upon me, like, oh, wow, okay. Try this. Oh, this works. Oh my gosh. And once it dawns upon you experientially, there's no turning back. It's like graduating from high school. You can't really go back to high school. You still go to the football games, the dances, you know, No, you're in college. You don't go back to high school. So I can't really go back. This is the issue I'm having right now, is what do? I've graduated from high school. High school is where you're trying all sorts of stuff. You're not really sure what you're going to do with your life. Graduate and you have an epiphany. It's like, or you have an epiphany, that's when you graduate. I said, oh my gosh, this is what works. Apex yoga works. This is it. Now I understand what the Dharma Kings have been talking about. So at that point, you graduate from high school. You're no longer, you know, talking to everybody. What do you think about this? Or what do you think about this? I read this book 3 days. I like kind of like a teacher. I like this teacher. You know, you're just all sorts of investigating and searching all around, which is like Facebook. Okay, I can't go back to Facebook. You know, at this point, because it's like going back to high school. Now I know what works. I'm not searching for what works. I know what works, and experientially, I've been experiencing it now. So, we open up with that, and we'll get to everything, all and everything here, if it goes that way. Apex yoga, what is that really? It's really mantra yoga, you might say. Mantra yoga, in a particular way. You simply affirm the truth of what you are. And you just keep affirming it. Now, when you do that, all these doubts will start creeping in, and all these strategies will start trying to creep in, and you just keep affirming what you are, and you don't react to any of these stratagems of doubt. You just keep affirming what you are, and you find they just dissolve. They dissolve. I've always heard that term, they dissolve. Well, it's true. It kind of like fades away like mist or something, where you don't pay attention to it, and it just, before you know it, it's gone. All this stuff that seems like super important, like life important kind of stuff. You pay no attention, you keep affirming, I am an apex yogin. And before you know it, it is completely gone. It is just gone. As Ramana Maharshi said, thoughts are like a fire full of wood, and you have one stick that you use to you know, stir the fire so you make sure all the other sticks and wood gets burned. And then ultimately, in stirring all of that, that one stick also gets burned. He says, so you use one thought to block all other thoughts, to dissolve all other thoughts. This is called mantra yoga or japa yoga. Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma said that japa yoga was the best yoga, the highest yoga, the fastest, the most effective, the supreme yoga. And I always said, what are you talking about? I mean, how is that possible? Well, she was talking about the real stuff. Bhakti yoga can be used as a type of japa yoga in terms of just, you can just focus, block all other focuses, totally block all other focuses. It's so important to do it that way. And you find out, oh my gosh, this actually works. This actually works. And In doing this, all sorts of amazingly subtle strategies arise to defeat this and keep us in delusion, in doubt. Including like the mirroring, everything you say, like it's mirrored, like a parrot repeating everything. And just like, what? And just, it's weird. All sorts of weird stuff in terms of mental strategy, you become aware of them. But you just keep saying, I am an apex yogin. Wow. 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 And you're just asserting what you are. Because the apex is reality. And the yogin is one who is reminding themselves of reality. So I'm an apex yogin. I'm reminding myself of reality by using this practice. I am an apex yogin. Very simple. Super supremely simple. Supremely simple. It's the supremely simple, effective, fast path. This is what the Dharma kings tell us. As Jesus says, I need do nothing. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Well, but I find you need to have this one thought to block all others. This is what the Dharma kings have told us. This is something that's come down through history. Many, many, many have taken this path, and it's worked for them. And I understand now why it works. It's, oh my gosh, this actually works. You could get to the deepest level of mind very quickly. Very, very quickly, actually. That's what we're afraid of, isn't it? We don't want it to be so effective. We say, oh, it's too scary. Not really. You just notice and say, that's interesting. Oh, yeah, so that's how my mind's working. Interesting. And it's exactly as the Dharma kings tell us. It's that we believe we're meditating a world. We say there's this, we're meditating a world, but here's the trick to it. What we do is we imagine there's a meditator doing the meditating of imagining a world. It's this imaginary meditation of imagination is what this world really is. But what we do is we imagine there's a meditator, and we imagine that the meditator is imagining the world, but it's really spirit that's imagining the world. So this meditator we call I or me, but it's not doing anything. It's not doing anything. It's like a puppet. And we say the puppet is imagining the world. It's not doing anything. So we say there is no I or there's no me, meaning it's not the doer. There's no doership taking place. When they hear the gurus say, Dharma kings say, there's no doership. They mean the me or the I is not imagining or doing anything. It's spirit that's directly doing everything. Directly. It's all direct. There's no indirection in what's taking place. What arises as the play of appearancing, ornamentation, it's all direct. But we're imagining it's indirect, going through this I or me. And so we're trying to figure out, you know, it's a totally false paradigm to look at it that way. And that's, most are stuck in this false paradigm. So by doing this apex yoga practice, 3 days' time, I was able to see this. I said, oh my gosh, wow. First I saw, this world's just a meditation. And then later, I put it together. I said, oh my gosh, the one that's doing the meditating isn't really doing it at all. It's really spirit. And there's this fake image of a meditator that we tell ourselves is doing the meditating. So we try to address this one as if it were real. This is where the complications and confusions arise. So just like the gurus have said, the Dharma kings, just like they've said, great corollary. I've had the flu now for a while, and I'm recovering from it. It swept through the Bay Area in a terrible way, but my really great fitness, conditioning, everything, it's been super helpful, and I'm on the path of recovering, and so I'm back to working out now again, which is cool. At least some working out. For me, I like to work on the golf swing, the strengthening the golf swing, because someday I say, I hope I can play golf again. That'd be nice. It'd be nice. I can't see the light at the end of the tunnel on that one, but you never know, right? You never know. God works in mysterious ways. So my goal is to swing speed. I want to hit it 360 yards. I really want to hit the drives far. It would be a different game of golf for me. My approach shots are good. I know I can work on those and make them quite good. And my putting's good, chipping's good. So everything is good. If I could just drive it far, it'll be a different game for me. So I've been working on this for a couple years now. And listening to a lot of advice, trying to sort it out. Kind of like spiritual path. You say, I want to go fast. How do I go fast? Well, you know to hit the ball far, golf, you have to have a fast swing speed. There's no other way. You can be a power lifter, but if you don't swing the club head fast, it's not going anywhere. It's how fast that club head is going through, and then, you know, hitting it on the sweet spot, which is what the pros are great, is hitting it on the sweet spot. They have terrific eye-hand coordination. They're very sort of freakishly athletic, the golf pros. But there's a problem with this, is that they're trying to score low, not trying to hit as far as possible. They're trying to make sure they hit it in the fairway, or, you know, they don't want to hook it out of bounds. Their shot is a draw, kind of right to left shot that rolls out and really goes far. But if you overcook that shot, it's going to hook and go out of bounds. And so that's what they have to guard against, is make sure. So they become very robotic. And the way the pros swing is designed, they already can hit it far. But they guard against the disaster, because that ruins their score. So they have golf swings designed in a certain way to guard against that hook, the disaster shot. And they're so athletic and talented, they can still hit the ball far, even with these swings. But these swings are really not good for the rest of us. And we've all been taught to swing this way like the pros. And it's killing our game. And so I came across this article by Jim Flick, I believe his name is. He's a super famous teacher. He's real old. I don't know if he's still around, but old school, old teacher, really wise teacher. And he says this, exactly what I'm saying. It was beautiful. He said, "You don't try to swing like the pros swing. It won't work for you. It will not work for you." And so he advocated, let the club head do the swing instead of the muscles and the core muscles and all this shoulder turn, all this kind of, let the club head do the swing, and you adapt around the speed of the club head. He said that's the way the players used to swing. And it worked great for them. In the days of wooden clubs and ballata balls, they still hit the ball extremely far. And so he explains all this quite clearly, and I said, wow, let me think about this. So I have this, like, a flexible plastic rod, so to speak, that very whippy. And I swing it, and you can hear it as it makes the sound, make it really strong, whoosh, you know, sound. So if you swing it faster, the pitch of the sound changes, so you can tell how fast you're swinging. So I keep trying different swings, and I can hear, you know, how effective it is by the sound of that whip going through. That whippy plastic rod makes that sound, and it changes. So I'm trying to see, you know, all different swings and listening to the sound. And I can hear, this doesn't work so good, this works better, etc. Very interesting. And I found that the swing that the pros use is good, but not real fast. It's very repeatable, very robotically repeatable. I can understand how they, you know, hit it so accurately, with power, with accuracy, but it's not the fastest swing at all. Very interesting. I discovered what the fastest swing is today, just now. I was trying to set this computer up to tape and having all sorts of problems. You know, I couldn't get this to open, couldn't get that to open. The computer died on me, and I had to restart. Had to restart again. It just went on and on. But every time I do something, I go then and work out. So it was great. Worked out great. I had like an awesome workout because I had all these computer problems. And I advise you, when you have computer problems, do a little workout as you're waiting for your computer to restart. Have a little 5 minute, two to five minute workout. It's perfect. So I feel great about that, and it's the grace of God that had all these computer problems, because I was working on the sound of that whippy plastic rod and different swings, and I found a swing that I realized, okay, that's maxing my speed out right there. It noticeably faster than the fastest kind of pro swing by coiling my body. coil the body, uncoil the body. That's the pro sort of thing. This thing was get the hands as high as possible and then whip the hands through ahead of the body, and the body then follows that. Totally different. It's an old school type of swing. Pretty old school. And noticeably faster. Very, very fast. And I said, okay, I got it. This is really fast and effective. There's no doubt about it. The ears did not lie, are not lying. Could hear it. And so here I have a corollary here between what did the old school Dharma King say? Mantra yoga is the fastest, best way. Why can the Tibetan Buddhists say you can do it in one lifetime, whereas the Theravadan Buddhists, the old school Buddhists, say, well, innumerable lifetimes is going to take you, innumerable. Whereas Tibetan Buddhists say, no, you can do it in one lifetime. Well, what's the difference? Well, Buddha, Gautama Buddha, taught sutra, which had a lot to do with your habits, your lifestyle, your commitment, your habits, how to govern your life, how to discipline your life, and just so he taught sort of an overall, general, big picture situation, how to move towards right meditation, etc. So he gave out a lot of helpful information to help out those at that time. But what Padmasambhava did, and supposedly his appearance was foretold by Buddha. They said, Buddha said, someone will come after me who's even greater than I am, who'll bring the mantra yoga type of situation. And this is what happened. Padmasambhava brought mantra or Vajrayana Buddhism. Before that, there was the original was Theravada or Hinayana Buddhism, and then Mahayana, or the larger vehicle they call it, became prevalent in India. It came very foremost, and that was supposedly faster, more powerful for those who were ready for it. But then Vajrayana Buddhism came along, and it's sort of the apex of Mahayana Buddhism, of how to go fast on the path. And then the top of the apex of Vajrayana Buddhism is what's called Dzogchen. And that is super fast. Super fast, you might say. And the fact is, there's nothing preventing anybody from going super fast. Not at all. Just to do mantra yoga, just state your identity. I am an apex yogin or yogini. I am an apex yogin. 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 Wow. Put the wow in there. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Like, this is amazingly, because you're headed towards realizing this. We're all apex. All of us, this instant, are apex. We're all direct. Everything is still direct. Everything is still apex, meaning at the core, direct, spontaneous, in the now. It's all the highest. It's all the highest. But we're imagining otherwise. So all we're doing is reminding ourselves of what's actually taking place right now. And the yogin, again, is one who's working at reminding themselves. So I am an apex yogin. I'm reminding myself. It's all apex. It's all apex. It always has been, always will be. But when we see that, it's wow. You know, I'm invincible. I'm an invincible apex yogin. Wow. So you need to put that wow in there, because this is going to be very wowish for us to see this. It's, oh my gosh. This is what, Buddha, all the Dharma kings, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, thank God for the Dharma kings, to simply remind us of the truth. So there's a corollary between this really fast path, what's the really fastest path, and swinging that golf swing. I'm trying to find what's the fastest way, and do I have the strength to do it? And so I'm doing all sorts of exercises, actually just a few, one simple one. I have this inch and a quarter PVC pipe filled with sand. It's about 5 feet, 4 feet, 4.5 feet high, tall, whatever you call it, long. And I grip it and I swing it like a golf club from really high, then through like that. And it's really heavy. Yeah, it's really heavy. Wow, what a workout that is. But I'm able to do it. So I've got a lot of strength. That goes to core, overall core body strength to be able to do that. You have to have full body strength to do this. And I'm able to do it. I'm doing this more and more and more and more and more. And that's a powerful, powerful practice. Actually, just that one practice is enough to groove tremendously powerful swing with tremendous speed to it. So that's just what I'm doing now. That's just what I'm doing. Now, I do other stuff to get the full body, full body. But mostly I'm focusing on the golf swing. I'll swing a 30-pound dumbbell too, with both hands, like it's a golf club, doing that. But I'm getting more and more focused on, okay, what I want to do, this is the result I want. So what do I need to really practice to get that result? Instead of just doing all manner of exercise, which really, you can do innumerable exercises, right? But how do you get that super, super high speed swing? You have to need tremendous flexibility. You have to get your hands really high. You have to dip your shoulder down. Your core's involved in that, and get the hands high, and then sort of more facing towards the target. That gives you more leverage, and then whip the whole thing through before the body even has a chance to catch up. Don't let the body lead. Let the arms and arms lead, and so you have to be really flexible. But, and then to be able to handle that strong core, agile, and all of that. But it's just like one exercise I'm doing, one exercise. So all the other exercises I've done have enabled me to do this one really effective exercise. And it's very similar to Apex Yoga. It's just one exercise we're doing. But all the other efforts we've done have built up enough strength. So we see, oh yeah, I can do this. I am an Apex Yogin. Wow. I am an Apex Yogin. Wow. So, it's amazing how external life sort of mimics the internal life, where I've come across one exercise that I realize, oh, this is really going to, this might, this could very well do it for me. It's like, holy cow. I've discovered what the fastest swing is for me. And I've discovered an exercise just by happen. How it happened was, it's crazy. I had a 10 foot piece of PVC I was using for flexibility exercises. I shake it kind of, it ends flex, and it puts a lot of stress on my shoulders, etc. And it snapped in half while I was doing that. So now I have 2 5-foot pieces. And so I plugged the end of one of them, and now I'm using that as a golf club. Actually, so it's a 5-foot golf club full of sand. I don't know how heavy it is, but and I also been swinging a dumbbell, one of those things. What do you call those things? Anyway, weights, swinging weights to strengthen the overall body and keep stretching the flexibility as much as possible. But so that's how it happened. Happenstance caused me to stumble across this wonderful practice. Amazing. Well, it's the grace of God. It wasn't happenstance. Just the perfect weight, too. The perfect weight to really push my practicing. So when stuff happens, don't get upset. Like when that broke, I said, huh, why did that break? I didn't say, I didn't pitch a fit. I just said, that's interesting. I wonder why that broke. I guess I'll find out later on. Well, now I found out. So whatever happens, don't be upset. Just say, okay, that should be really interesting to see, how this plays in my favor down the road. Everything is in your favor. Everything that's happening is in your favor if you go with that flow and resolve to continue to improve your game, your spiritual game. I met this old woman, old elderly lady in the market today, and we first started talking about how terrible the avocados were, and she told me it was awful, and she told me why, and then she explained she was an expert in food quality, having 6 generations of being restaurateurs and hoteliers and in that business for 6 generations. She was from New York. She talked about the Hamptons a lot, and she was just telling me how absolutely rotten the food was out in California. How, they'd say it's how fresh, how wonderful. She said it's not at all. They get it from different countries, and it's not very good at all. And so she said that she would send back east. She ships stuff out overnight in dry ice or something, lobster, steak, what various all sorts of things. She ships out from back east, and she says the price is still way cheaper than if I bought it here. Way cheaper. It's amazing. And it's, she says it's way superior and fresher than the food out here. And she said the food out here is just crud. It's killing people. She says awful. And she has a point. I understand what she's saying. And then she went on to talk about a whole raft of stuff. And it was just amazing how intelligent she was. And she said, New Yorkers, she said, we just tell it like it is. And people don't like that. We just tell it like it is. And I say, yeah, I know. I appreciate that. I love that. And she's got a wonderful sense of humor. She says, people out here, there's no sense of humor anymore. And she said, the country's upside down and backwards, and it's just cuckoo right now. And she said all sorts of interesting stuff. How she said she made a remark in a bank that was overheard. And it was just a remark of saying, you know, people are kind of screwed up and not. Don't know really what they're doing so well anymore, which is totally true, right? And someone then went to the bank manager or something and told them what she said, and then they came to her and said and told her she's no longer welcome in the bank. They don't want her banking there. They've blocked her from banking there. It's like, and she told me what she said. It was just an innocuous thing. For me, it's like nothing. It's just telling the truth. It's telling the truth. It's just like anything I would say here. And she was blocked from banking. How about that? It's just amazing some of the stuff she was telling me. And so, anyway, the gist of it, I guess, I said, why is this? Well, getting the stuff from back east. Well, this teaching we're getting, Apex Yoga, is from the east, isn't it? Yes, it is. It's from Longchenpa, who Longchenpa explained it the best. Okay, so he's the supreme adept of the apex approach. He explained it the best. But Padmasambhava brought mantra yoga to the world. Padmasambhava really brought it in its highest form. Okay, of course, the rishis, Hindu rishis, had some mantra yoga going, and it was known. But Padmasambhava really, you know, is perfected. He's the perfection of mantra yoga. And this has flourished as Tibetan Buddhism, especially Dzogchen. Especially Dzogchen. And Longchenpa, I was reading his book again today, Spaciousness, the Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart, translated by Keith Dauman. And I just see it, what he's saying so clearly now. It's amazing. And kudos to Keith Dauman again. It may be one of the greatest feats of Western writing in history, his commentary in this book. You know, it's astonishing that a Westerner could be so insightful, really. And so he's just he's done a great service. You know, he's astonishing in his own right that he can somehow express this in a Western way to us without, you know, losing the flavor of it. It's an amazing feat by Keith Dauman. But Longchenpa, you know, he just lays it out so beautifully, and it's, you know, it's the apex. It's apex teaching, Dzogchen teaching. We can say apex approach, that's fine. Just like Ramana said, use one thought to block all other thoughts, we can say apex approach to realize no approach. Okay? That's fine. That's necessary because of our extreme bias. We have to gain familiarity, counter our bias. We have to counter our bias through the familiarity of practicing. This is required. I mean, bias just doesn't depart on its own. I'm sorry. Those people, the world, everyone in the world is thinking that they'll just wait and bias will just depart on its own. How can that happen? Is the bias of familiarity. So if you just stick with what you're familiar with, you're just reinforcing the bias of familiarity. It gets worse. So there's a problem. The reason why Dzogchen was not given out, this highest mantra yoga, apex yoga, is because it's easy for those who haven't even begun the spiritual path and not even tried to misinterpret it and think, oh, we don't need to do anything. See? So we could just stay where we're at and keep on what we're doing. Well, what we're doing is just nourishing our bias against certainty constantly. So if you just stay with what you're doing, you're just going to get even worse, more bias. So there's that possibility of misinterpreting Dzogchen. And you know, that has, to some extent, the West has misinterpreted the Eastern teachings, and this is why the West is so screwed up, to say the least. And that's affected the whole world now. The whole world's screwed up. But never more than the West, and especially here in California, to say the least, in the Bay Area, to be more specific. I mean, wow. You know, it's like a little bit of Dzogchen's a dangerous thing, okay? This is what they were getting at. A little bit of Dzogchen is a very dangerous thing. And the baby boom generation got a little bit of Dzogchen. A little bit of this, a little bit of that, and a little bit of Dzogchen. It sort of permeated our culture. And this is a very bad thing. It's a very bad thing. I didn't get any Dzogchen until Longchenpa, you know, initiated me directly. And I said, oh. Even then, I didn't know. I had no idea what it was. I just experienced pure intrinsic spaciousness after meeting Longchenpa in a dream, and I said, "That's it. Okay, that's easy. So what's the problem?" I said, "Of course, that's it. How could I not known that?" And then only after that, I began did a Google search on spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness, and I found this book by Keith Dalman, translated by Keith Dalman. You know, from Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart by Longchenpa, and I read the book, and I said, oh my gosh, you know, so what is this? Oh, they call this a Dzogchen? This is what they're saying Dzogchen is? I don't know what the, you know, whatever. That label doesn't really matter. Don't believe that what is merely label actually exists. That's a delusion we have in the world. It's like we label the sky. Sky's ocean, and we think, oh, there's an ocean. You know, it's an ocean there. No, it's the sky. We think if we label something, that it's actually what the label says. It's ridiculous. Anyway, I didn't know anything about Dzogchen before that. And so I just got it straight. I got the experience first from Longchenpa, and then the teaching later, just to say reinforce that, yeah, this is the pointers to this experience. And I said, oh, okay, that's fine. It's like that. That's the right way to go about it. And I had prepared by a lifetime of practice with other teachings, like A Course in Miracles. For now, it's just, you know, going on for almost 40 years. So, and all sorts of new thought and non-dualism, and just everything. I mean, I've been schooled in just about everything, but I had not been schooled in the apex approach until, you know, I met Longchenpa first, and then he started schooling me in the apex approach. So I take it very seriously and work at it constantly, and this is what's required. But the popularization of Dzogchen among the hippie generation, the baby boomers, and the subsequent generations, of kind of like, you know, yeah, let's smoke some pot maybe read a little Dzogchen or hear something and say, wow, yeah, that's cool, yeah, spaciousness, awesome, yeah, okay, don't need to do anything. Hey, you say, hey, we're not doing anything right now, so I'm getting high, yeah, this is great, yeah, I don't need to do anything. Okay, so that is not what Padmasambhava envisioned when he brings mantra yoga into the world. And the Tibetans, I mean, they go after it like it's the most serious thing there is, and it is. And it's treated as sacrosanct, and you know, they're spiritual warriors about it. So they think nothing of sitting in a cave for 10 years, practicing this mantra, you know, living on berries. So we aren't doing that in the West. I am sorry, but we're a bunch of dilettantes here. And Blancchampa felt that I was enough of a hard worker that he could risk introducing me to this apex approach. Because all I've done my whole life is work like I'm in a cave eating berries, you know. So I have this super work ethic. And that's what's really required. You can't trifle with this stuff. Otherwise, it becomes a self-righteous mania complex, you know. Syndrome, a self-righteous syndrome. And this is what's matter with the Western world. They have this self-righteous syndrome that they think is backed up by, you know, the highest teachings, you know, and they're just out to lunch on this. They're just out to lunch. It's a real problem. Like, so a little bit of Dzogchen is a very dangerous thing. It's a very devilish thing. It really is. So they kept Dzogchen from almost everybody. It was a secret teaching, only for those who were ready for it. And then the lamas would know if you're ready for it, then they'd introduce you to some Dzogchen teacher or something. But you had to be really good. You had to show that you really have the right stuff through tremendous trials and efforts and progress and showing that you're able to discipline your mind, your life, your habits, and you work at it incessantly. You're really committed and all this stuff. Only then would you be introduced to the apex approach. Only the top ones were introduced to it. It's called Samaya. They don't want this teaching because a little bit of Dzogchen is a devilish thing. It's a doubtful thing. It really can be. Yeah. But I speak of this not knowing who's listening, because I don't know. It could always be someone who is really working hard at it, and they very well could be introduced to it through an inner initiation. Like White Longchampa. Just like it happened with me. I had no idea who Longchampa was. All I know was I met this person in a dream. Next morning I had this experience of, you know, intrinsic spaciousness. And I knew this is enlightenment. I knew this is it. This is the goal. It's just so simple. So simple. And then I knew that this man in the dream was the one that had brought this to my attention. No doubt about it. Because I had asked for some great spiritual help the day before, and I knew this dream was in response to that, because it the whole dream was about and the entrance and all, someone walking across the water, crossing a vast ocean, and the talking. I said, wow, this is the response of my prayer, and then experiencing the pure spaciousness, of course, and then finding out later it was Longchampa. There's no doubt about it. No doubt about it. So it can happen to anyone who's really putting the work in. Who knows? You might suddenly change your tune. Suddenly change your tune. Then you say, oh, it was a very big shift in my life where I just suddenly realized, oh my gosh, I have to pick my game up. There's a faster approach. There's a better approach. And I'm called to that approach. Just like the golf swing, I see now there really is a faster swing, but nobody's teaching that. None of the golf instructors teach that. They all teach the stuff, you know, that ruined Tiger Woods' back or knees and the modern pros, these super athletes that have spent their whole life in a gym. You know, they're freaks of nature, you might say. They're workout maniacs. And they also have this extraordinary eye-hand coordination. This is Bubba Watson, one of the longest hitters in history. They say, Bubba, how do you hit it long? He said, look, let me be honest with you. I've got super great eye-hand coordination for one thing. I practice like a maniac for another. And the most important thing, he says, I hit it on the sweet spot just about every time. I hit it perfect just about every time. And he says, that's got a lot to do with it. The other part is that he's got like a perfect swing for speed. Hands real high and lets the hands whip through first. The arms, hands whip through first. He's got the great, you know, all the leverage is just there. It's beautiful. So he's got it all. But They hit it, you know, right on the sweet spot of the club. Just the right area of the ball. The ball's teed up just right. The right launch angle. The right spin. I mean, they've got everything dialed in, and they can repeat it over and over. He says, I rarely miss. He said, I rarely miss, and it's true. Seems like he hits it, you know, just right almost every time. It's like, wow. He says, you know, he's kind of a freak of nature. He's able to do that. So, but he has that swing, and it works. So I know this swing I could hit is it works, it works, it works, no doubt. And this apex yoga approach, it works, it works. I tried it out 3 nights in a row, all night long. I was doing it. I was tired. I said, you know, I'm not trying to compete with anybody. I'm not trying to compete with the Buddha. I'm not, you know, four, what I do, four nights or what, I don't know how long, but was it 44? I don't know. But you know, he just like said, okay, this is it. I'm gonna do it. And you can do the same, actually. If you really did what the Buddha did, just focus on affirming your identity, and all these temptations arise. That is all, what he talked about, all these temptations. Exactly. But you just don't pay any attention. You just keep affirming your identity, and they just dissolve. And ultimately, you keep doing that, they'll all dissolve away. You'll recognize that you are the one imagining this whole realm of conditioned existence. And the meditator we thought was doing it isn't doing anything at all. And you will realize that, and then you will go beyond that, which Buddha did. And you can do it just like Buddha did, actually. But there's no competition. There's no competition. So I was really tired. I have to work, you know, and my work is very demanding. So I said, and I was really kind of exhausted and really wowed out, and said, well, you know, yeah, I get it. You could, but I'm not in competition with Buddha. I'm not in competition with anyone. I'm just playing my game. So don't ever compete on the spiritual path, okay? Don't ever compete. That's really stupid to do that. Just stay within what your uniqueness, how much you can do. Don't push yourself thinking you need to compete. Now, if you can do it fast, then do it fast. But don't think you're competing with anyone. Do not do that. So I said, well, I need to rest the fourth night and the fifth night. But I did last night. I tried to do as much as possible, and then I switched over to the daytime. And so then I started using all these different encounters as I go around my day, so many different situations, to try to remember to do this mantra. And I kept forgetting. And I found out that we have this, what we're taught is, when we come into this world, is we're taught that, oh, you have to be nice to people, and you have to change your mantra, change your identity. When you deal with people, you don't want to upset them you know, being enlightened. So you have to be unenlightened when you deal with people. And I found this has been hammered into everyone here, and certainly hammered into me. And so whenever I interact with someone, automatically I switch into this other mode, and I completely forget about the mantra. And then what happens is, when I say, oh my gosh, I forgot, and I try to go back to the mantra has been changed in my mind. Like if I'm dealing with kind of a moron type of mentality, I'll go back to the mantra and I'll say, okay, I am an apex moron. And I'll say, what? So how'd that change? So what happens is you take on the flavoring of those people you meet, and that actually changes your affirmation of your identity. This is what I've discovered. It's a great discovery. And I wanted to make that discovery. I said, well, so I by experimenting, I'm finding out, oh my gosh, you know, we forget our identity, because you're supposed to, this world tells you, you got to forget your identity. And in order to interact with people, you have to be, you know, on their level of doubt and forgetfulness. And so we're all habituated to that. And it's a terrible habit. And trying to break that habit I'm having a tough time. I keep forgetting. Get a phone call. You're going to call someone. Immediately you forget. And you're on the level of a moron again. It's kind of funny. I try to recover the mantra, how depending on who I meet, it's changed in a certain way. Like, I am a apex stupid person, or I'm an apex fool, or I'm an apex time waster, or I'm an apex, and I have to keep remembering, what? No, where am I? Oh, I'm an apex yogin, that's right. And then I get back, and I suddenly feel better again. I'm back stating the truth of my identity instead of a lie about my identity. So I find that everyone I meet, I get a lie about my identity back, and it affects my mind such that the mantra that I say is changed. I change it. But not everybody. And everyone's different. And some people, I'm able to keep the mantra in my mind. I can tell where people are at depending on how severely difficult it is for me to keep the mantra in mind when I'm talking with them. Some people, it's very difficult. Others, like Ram Maharshi, I can look at him, I don't forget at all. The Dharma Kings, I don't forget at all. Because they're constantly reminding me, okay, I am an apex yogin. I am an apex yogin. I am an invincible apex yogin. It doesn't leave me. And some people, it's easier than others. It doesn't leave you so much. And others, wow. I mean, it is way gone. And you'll be like stumbling around like, maybe it'll take you 10 minutes you'll forget and say, oh my God, I forgot. How did I forget? I go into the situation saying, okay, I got to remember this, life or death. 10 minutes later, I realize the last 10 minutes, I've been completely blanked out, completely forgot. And I say, oh my, it says life and death and you forgot? That's horrible. And yet it happens like that. But it's very interesting to experience this. It's fun in a way, right? It's like, holy cow. I told myself, I have to remember this. It's the most important thing. It's life or death. And I forget it like that. And just blank out. Phone calls, the computer, smartphones, anything like that. I got a text message. You'll completely forget about I am an apex yogin. You will completely forget about it. That really wise lady I met today, she says, I don't have a computer. I don't have a cell phone. She said that stuff just messes you up. I don't want anything to do with it. You know, it's like, wow, no wonder why you're so wise still. You haven't lost it. And I didn't lose it. I was talking with her. I remembered, I am an apex yogin. I'm an apex yogin. I was able to remember it while I was speaking with her in the midst of the conversation. I didn't forget it. It was really quite astonishing. So you see how far we've fallen is most people I meet, boy, I mean, yeah, I might say, I am a drug-using maniac. You know, I might say, I am a drug-using maniac. I say, wait a minute, that's who I was talking with. That's not me. I'm an apex yogin. But I was talking to a drug-using maniac, and it got into me. So I thought that was I'm supposed to take on that identity for myself. So you were taught here, we're supposed to take on the identity of the people who are already in the world. Well, if they're all forgetful of their true identity, then what we're really taking on is forgetfulness of our true identity, which helps no one. It just perpetuates aimlessness. Severe bias against certainty, which is fear. Tremendous fear, continuity fear arises, severe continuity fear, because we have no choice but to be what we are. Everything is still direct, and the fact that this is still there freaks us out. So we get terrified of ourselves, and we have the inner conflict with our own mind, and then we have all these defenses against this inner conflict, dissociation, splitting, psychosis of all different kinds, all sorts of mental health problems, innumerable. And we say, oh, that's good. Let's just, you know, have our espresso and smoke pot in the morning and everything's good. Just keep the continuity bias, you know, continuity fear and the bias, familiarity bias going. And that's what we call life. It's really an insane asylum is what it is. Now, I said to that wise woman I met today, I said, you know, I want to get out of California. It's the cuckoo's nest here, to say the least. And she goes, yeah. And then she says, but this state's messed up. This place is messed up. This place is messed up. And then she goes, where are you going to go? She had this wonderful New York accent. Where are you going to go? I said, yeah, that's the question, isn't it? Yeah. She said, I don't know where to go. She goes, I don't know where to go anymore. Well, I don't either. And so that, I said, God, you know, you got some work to do. You know, you have not yet told. I'm telling everyone, you know, there's other realms, reduced intensity zone realm. But we need, you know, it may come to that. And she was speaking about, she thinks it's probably the end time. She's probably, the way things are, is what religion says. She says, I don't want to talk religion, but it did say this, you know, and we're here. And I said, we're here. We are here. Well, apex yoga certainly is great preparation for whatever, you know, for whatever. It really is the supreme practice, the apex practice. It really is. It's as fast as you want it to be. I mean, you could just go in and just do it, power through. But it takes tremendous maturity to do that. That's why Buddha was able to do it. He had tremendous maturity. He had tried the path of meditation. He had tried the path of asceticism. And then he said, you know, then suddenly he remembered something from his childhood. And he said, oh, that's it. And he just did that, powered through, and he was awakened, you know, from false identity, from doubt. He said, the other ways don't work. They don't work. Which is true. So, but he had tremendous maturity. And I can see why, because you cannot, the practice is you just let all this stuff dissolve. Good, bad, indifferent, whatever. Whatever line of thought comes up, you just stay with, I am an apex yogin, wow. And it dissolves. But it's so tricky. It wants to pull you into agreeing or disagreeing with whatever arises. You want to, and you just have to take a neutral stance on everything that arises. It's just, you're not interested. I'm an apex yogin. Wow, that's what I'm interested in. And that's it. But then it gets more and more and more subtle and intense. And I haven't taken it all the way through yet, but I've certainly glimpsed great depths of it. And I said, okay, well, sure, if you have great maturity, you just keep doing it. And that will happen for me at some point. It happened for all of us. So we don't have to, again, compete with the Buddha just powering it through like that. But I'm just saying it's possible if you have the maturity. But don't take drugs to try to make it happen. That's a huge mistake. You have to remain very dispassionate. Calm, dispassionate. All these temptations to tempt you into bad habits will arise, into patterns of doubt. All these clever temptations arise. And so, if you haven't disciplined your life, you're going to get enthused about this opportunity, because it seems like, oh, this is a great opportunity is presented. All these deals are like presented. All the mind presents all these deals, says, hey, you know, look at this. Yeah, you've really got me. You really put the screws to me here, but okay, I want to make a really great deal. Here's this great deal, and you can do this. And you don't even evaluate it in the practice. You don't evaluate it. You just say, I'm an apex yogin. Wow. But if you've got this really great, so-called great deal presented to you, the temptation is to start evaluating it, and then you've lost the practice, just like that. Because it won't dissolve. As long as you want to evaluate it, your mind will not allow it to dissolve. And you lose the momentum of the practice, and you get swept away then by some enthusiasm. Like, oh, what a deal I've got for myself. So it wasn't easy. The first night was pretty easy. Second one was really tough. Really tough. Third one was extremely tough as well. And last night I tried again, and very tough, because this the mind was just mirroring everything I said as if it was saying it, you know. And I didn't know how to combat that, but I just kept trying to repeat, I am an apex yogin, wow. I am an apex yogin, wow. And so you just have to keep doing it, just like that. Simple. Keep it absolutely simple. Just that simple. So, but not easy to get to this. I mean, I spent my whole life and only recently got to it. On the, you know, February 13th, the birthday of Longchenpa, suddenly I got to it. I said, ah, here's your birthday present, Longchenpa. Lifetime of not getting to it. So it's not easy to really get to it and decide, okay, this commit to it, this is what I'm going to do. I'm an apex yogin, that's it. I am an apex yogin. And when you do that, it's like you graduate from high school. You can't go back. You can't go back. It's not possible. It just doesn't feel right anymore. It feels awkward, like you don't fit in with the crowd anymore, right? you go away to college and you try to go back to high school and you realize, ah, wow, I used to be that way. I don't fit in here anymore at all, right? It's really quite similar to that. So I'm an apex yogin. It means I practice this way now. And that's it. But again, quite different than those who don't, who are still, on massive shopping trips and expeditions of looking here and looking there and looking all around, which of course I've been there and done that. The ego doesn't want you to know about mantra yoga and how effective it is. We don't want to know because our continuity but fear, we're so biased against what works, we blind ourselves to it. And again, Sri Sri Anandamayi Mata always kept saying, Java Yoga is the best. And I said, ah, boy, I don't know what you're talking about. I just don't understand that. I didn't say she was wrong. I just said, I just don't get it. I don't get it. What do you mean? Just sitting there mouthing something over and over. How could that be effective at all? Well, it is. If you do it in the way it's intended, with your heart and souls in it, you're committed. You're blocking all other thoughts. That's all. And you get used to thoughts dissolving, whole syndromes dissolving, all these deals just dissolving. You get familiar with that. And then you say, oh, that's no problem. I just dissolve whatever arises, I just dissolve it. Even if the idea of paradise arises, just dissolve it. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. So not many are willing to practice in that way. And because of that, they, stay in high school. They're still thinking that some thoughts, are intriguing. But we're all that way. I was that way up until just recently. So nothing to condemn. It's just to be aware of it. Be aware of it. I mean, we all realize we're coming up short. So just to, reminding everyone you're coming up short, that's the sangha, that's the dharma, that's helping everyone out. So you're coming up short. You got to work at it more. That's just, I like this wise woman again said today. She says you can't say anything to anybody. Their skin is so thin, you can't just tell it like it is to them at all. They can't tolerate it at all. They're just completely constipated, as you would say. Completely constipated, all stuck up, completely stuck up. And so the idea of just saying, you're coming up short, that they think that's like, fighting words or something. Like, what? That's what a friend does, is you're coming up short. It's like, we're kind of like, the world's kind of like people wandering in a desert where there's no water. They're dying of thirst, and someone comes along who knows where there's this wonderful oasis, and they're thoroughly hydrated, they have water, they're even carrying some water. So here, and they say, where'd you get the water? I'll lead you there. I know exactly where it is. I know how to get there. It's easy. And then they're like real suspicious, like, wait a minute, maybe you're trying to trick me. Maybe you're insane. What do you mean you said there's water? We haven't found it. You must be crazy. If there was any water, we could find it. And it's like you're devil trying to mislead us, And they get into this whole thing like you, but you're the, they get freaked out when you say, hey, I know the way. Yeah, I know where there's water. It's not as easy, because they think that they're the smartest in the room. And if they can't find it, nobody can. So you must be deceiving them, and you're like some terrible deceiver. This is the problem with the world now. The education, those who have succeeded in playing the education game, or now in power, the ones running the world are those who've 99.99% are those who've gone through modern universities. Okay, the modern throughout the entire world, almost all the leaders, bureaucracy, the cabinet members, they all have been trained in the modern educational university system. A lot of them came to the United States for their schooling. A lot of the aristocrats are sent here from other countries to get their schooling, and they go back. So they're all birds of a feather. And so they all have this complex of thinking they're the smartest people in the room. And the truth be told, they're not even close to that. They haven't even started the spiritual path. They're not even kindergartners, actually. They're not even kindergartners. But They have this complex, like if we can't find the water, there must be no water. So anyone who says they know where there's water, they say, you're a liar, you're a deceiver, you're insane. And they start, this jabbering, like monkeys jabbering, It's just like, it's meaningless jabber. They don't know what they're talking about. My education was both Western university kind of education and outside that box. I realized I had to have this parallel education. I started when I was 12 years old. I said, enough of this. I could see this is leading nowhere except to entitlement superiority complex, or you'll be an educated fool. And so I just turned my attention away from it. I still continued on, so I would make sure that I was very highly educated in that way, so people wouldn't think I was a fool. But at the same time, my emphasis was on total outside the box education, a true spiritual education, coming from the grace of God. So I'm able to relate to those who have a modern Western education, easily, talk and relate with them. But I have this other education completely outside the box of the modern educational system, completely outside of that box, the real Dharma King education. I have that too. And that's very rare in this world, very rare. But still, I mean, they think I'm pretentious if I say one word. I say, who are you? I don't, where's your diploma? I mean, where's your, status? I mean, you're no smarter than us, right? I mean, we got a university degree, Where'd you get your degree? Say, okay, well, we're equals then, right? No, I'm like, in college of spiritual college, and you haven't even started preschool yet. I'm an apex yogin, and you haven't even started preschool. But you're dying of thirst, so let me lead you to the water. Say, no. This is what I get. This is what we get. It's nuts right now. Again, the inmates are running the asylum. Our bias against certainty has developed this educational system to try and empower doubt, and to say that our bias is right. We're right. We're biased against certainty, and we're right about that. And so they've now got a diploma. It says, you are Mr. and Mrs. So-and-so, now have a diploma that you're now an expert in proving that doubt is correct, and the bias against certainty is a factual, accurate bias. You're justified, and you now have a diploma certifying that this is indeed, you are an expert at that, and you are right about that. And this is it. This is what the world has come to. So the world was way wiser in the past, way wiser. We have forfeited our wisdom in this world right now. And so, and now we're trying to get it back, and people are screaming bloody murder. Like, no, we're right. We can't possibly be wrong. A little bit of Dzogchen is a dangerous thing. A really dangerous thing. But on the other hand, there's nothing stopping anyone from just repeating the truth of their identity, really, and which is here. You'd have to say, I'm an apex yogin. I'm an or yogini. I'm an apex yogin or yogini. Accepting that, if you accept that's what you are, then you are putting yourself in the apex position, meaning everything is you're agreeing, fundamentally accepting that everything is direct. It's reality. Everything's flawlessly direct as it's always been. This is what Dzogchen is pointing out. Tibetan Buddhism, Rigpa. It's one way of putting it. Some people call it Turiya, the fourth state, enlightenment, guru vision, whatever. It's just seeing reality as it is. It's always direct. It's always just here, spontaneous, simultaneous in the now. It's very simple. When you see it, it's just, of course. How could it be any other way? Crazy to believe it could be anything other than that. Now, I urge, you know, everyone to really keep their familiarity going. You don't want to backslide during these times. So right now, you know, most may not be able to actually do this practice. You know, it takes tremendous desperation and maturity, combination of the two, to really do it and commit to it enough so that you see, oh my gosh, this truly works. So if you can't do it, okay, what's the next best thing? Don't backslide. Don't lose your momentum. Don't go in the wrong direction right now. Stay very much, you know, in touch with. Don't make a fixation on high school. Just say, I gotta graduate. And just make like graduation from high school is like an obsession with, you know, just be obsessed with it. I've got to graduate from high school. But at the same time, you're still in high school and you realize that. But you say, man, I don't want to try to say that high school is it. That's it. Because that's a really dangerous thing to do. I'll end up becoming a self-righteous maniac, without doubt. Without doubt. The Bay Area is full of them now. Full of them. They're really self-righteous maniacs at this point. It's not a joke. I mean, they'll burn you at the stake in a few years, maybe next year. Seriously. The same mindset that has caused, you know, throughout history, atrocities throughout history, it's the exact same mindset at work here. That Jesus pointed that out as the most dangerous mindset. A little spiritual teaching is a dangerous thing. The Pharisees and Sadducees, ones who crucified Jesus, were exactly the same mindset as the folks here in the Bay Area who have a little bit of Dzogchen, so to speak, and are very dangerous because of it. Very, 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 very self-righteous, and they say high school's it. There's nothing beyond high school. That's it. We're the seniors in high school, and we rule. Seniors rule. You know, that kind of thing, and they're trying to intimidate the freshmen. And I come along, being in college, I say, hey, wait a minute. You know, stop bullying the freshmen, man. You're making it so tough for them. Making it so tough for them. Yeah, there's so. It's supremely simple. Reality is supremely simple. That's all it is. It's supreme simplicity. And we just need to affirm that supreme simplicity. I'm an apex yogin. That's it. Wow. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. That's it. Just repeat it over and over and over in your mind. Do it all night. I mean, I'm sleeping during the daytime now, so I can do it all night. But my sleep schedule is completely messed up. It's a real pain. I'm struggling, like I'm sure a lot of us are struggling right now, along with the flu and everything else, just, you know, it's the whole constellation, but like I said, 99% is great for me. I've gained like 4 pounds during the flu, because I felt so hungry, I had to eat, keep my strength up. Now I got to lose it again, which is going to be very difficult. But I feel strong. You know, I'm back on the kale smoothies and my diet. I when I had the flu, I kind of started eating Cheetos and potato chips and whatever, right? You know, but one thing I didn't do, there's a lot of stuff I didn't do, which shows why good habits are so important. My habit is don't eat any sweets, especially chocolate. No chocolate. As soon as I start eating chocolate, it's been my history where I lose my discipline, my dieting discipline. I lose it. I know I have to avoid that. And I didn't eat any chocolate. There was chocolate all over the place. And I said, no, I can't go that far. I got to draw a line somewhere. If you don't draw a line somewhere, you won't draw any line. Okay, and you'll be in a swamp. So I didn't look at the news. I didn't look at any news. I drew the line and said, I was tempted, but I'm not going to do that. I said, yeah, but I'm sick with the flu. It made me feel good. I said, no. I've worked too hard on my habits to throw them away just because I have the flu. So when you're sick, it's very dangerous. You start to go go back into bad habits because you justify it. You say, well, I feel so sick. It's okay. You make me feel good. I said, no. We can work out of this. We can work out of this flu. So good habits are still in place. Not all of them as much as I'd like, but the really significant ones. I prevented myself from backsliding, okay, which is what I'm saying to you is keep your good habits going. Keep saying, I've got to graduate, I've got to graduate, I've got to graduate. And keep that intensity going like that. Now, will you graduate? I can't promise anything. Because who knows when it comes suddenly comes upon you. Oh yes, this work will work for me, I'll do this. But I can't say when it'll come upon anyone. And will this life be your final life? Well, if you don't do mantra yoga properly, it won't be your final life. But it could be the one just before your final life, the second to final, right? Your next one could be the final one. So you want to, at all costs, work towards that, towards graduating. He said, even if it takes another life, I'm not going to give up working at this because I am sick and tired of the high school mentality, that juvenile high school mentality. I've just had enough of it. Had enough of it. Don't backslide. There, you know, keep working at good habits. Now, when you're sick, you know, it's like, I feel like I lost all my balance and coordination stuff. Well, I did. My balance is lousy, stumbling around. That's just because the flu, what the effect the flu has was, you know, it's not, flu's really messes up your overall feeling of fluidity. You know, the flu messes your fluidity up. It flew away. And so I feel kind of clumsy. You know, I don't like feeling clumsy, but that's how, and tired, you feel, get tired easily, clumsy, uncoordinated, all this stuff. And so I said, oh, it set me back, you know, months of, I was in such great shape and this set me back so severely, but not as severely as it could have. Not anywhere close. In fact, I'm getting through it really well actually. So all the effort I've done in my life helped me really kind of sail through this flu, and I'm now starting to, you know, recover. I realize I'm not in such bad shape after all, and the balance will come back, and the coordination, everything will come back, and before you know it, I'll be sailing along pretty well. Now, it'll probably have some lingering effects. The flu tends to do so, right? You just have to accept this and just work all the harder, you know, on recovery. And don't feel sorry for yourself. Don't cry about it. Don't whine about it, right? Just say, okay, well, I got to, you know, pay the price to get back to some close to what I was before. And can we get ultimately better than we were before? I don't know. You know, maybe. It's possible, right? Possible. But you expect that, you know, these hits will happen like this. And so it's how you rebound from them that's really important. And so that's why I say, stay with this ideal of, I've got to graduate. I've got to graduate from high school. I've got to graduate. Okay, what do I got to do? And it's got nothing to do with the high school teachers giving you a grade or anything. It has to do with you suddenly realizing, okay, oh, you know, some sudden shift will happen in your life, and you'll just suddenly click, and you just suddenly realize, oh, I don't need high school anymore. I've got college now. You just suddenly feel collegiate, you know, in your spiritual collegiateness. You just suddenly realize, oh, I can specialize in this. Now I know what I wanted to go to college for. Oh, yeah, I'm going to specialize in this approach, and I can do it. And you suddenly mature, and it can happen just in the blink of an eye, really. And, you know, there'll be a little time where you kind of miss high school a little bit. I kind of, you know, just me, like Facebook, I just feel like, I don't feel like going back to it. I really don't. I said, well, what am I going to do with my time? I don't know. I don't know exactly. But Something will have to arise, and to how do I spend my time if I'm not doing all the stuff I used to do in high school? That's a challenge in itself, isn't it? Facebook, is what it is, isn't it? It's sort of intoxicating. It's like high school, very intoxicating, especially when you get used to it like a senior, and at some point you say, "Whoa, wait a minute here. Is this, yeah." Time to put the brakes on it. And say, "Wait a minute. Is this going to reach? Am I going to? Is this helping me graduate? Is this the way to graduation? Or am I just having partying, having a senior party all year, and it may just continue indefinitely?" Rarely do you see a kid these days without their smartphone and without them looking at it. Rarely, 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 rarely. Think about it. They take it with them wherever they go. With their parents, they're constantly paying attention to it. Wow. Yeah. Wow. Being brought up to be professional high schoolers is what they're being brought up to be. Like that, yeah, that's it. That's all there is to it. I got to get, super great grades in university, get a great job so I can survive, and that's all there is to it. So don't backslide, watch out. And if you do backslide, which we all will to one extent or another, you just catch it, notice it. Okay. Just like in this practice, Apex Yoga. You catch yourself, you got off track, you forgot to state what you are, and you just say, "Oh, I got off track. Okay, and sometimes you try to remember, it's like, "Ah, oh, I can't remember." You need a mnemonic device. I use a mnemonic device, which is a little memory device for that works for me, and you can come up with one of that works for you. Can be anything at all. And for me, it's like I say, who am I dealing with here in the world? It's apes. They're like, apes. There's another ape. Ape. Apex. Oh, apex. Yeah, I'm an apex. So apex. Why? Apes. Why? Why is everyone apes? Apex. Why? Yoga. Oh, yoga. Apex yoga. Ape. So it helps me remember like really quickly. Whereas before, I was struggling. I was struggling to remember when I got knocked off track. I couldn't remember. I'm like, what was I saying? I can't remember what I was saying. Even though I said it thousands of times, it was like I couldn't remember at all. What am I saying? Just blank out. I said, "That's weird. That's weird. Isn't this world a weird place? It's a super weird place. Super weird place." Getting this video done here before it gets too late, before it gets too dark. Definitely has clouded over, but we're not going to get very much rain out of this one. Just some showers, and that's it. And then next week, spring-like conditions get better and better and better and better. Gorgeous. It's gorgeous today until the cloud, the front moved in. It's like, oh my gosh, California has re suddenly returned. It's like, oh, how nice! Holy cow! We forgot how nice it can be here as we walk under the palms. So again, where do we go? Where can we go in this world that's can get away from this, educated ignorance, as Ramana Maharshi calls it, that we're now has be, really, it's the fruits of that are coming apparent to us, and the fruits are terrible. Very scary. I mean, those of us who have wisdom education are quite scared about what's going on, because we realize that they're saying that, they're equal to us, even though they haven't even started. And if we start telling them the truth, and then they start screaming, "We're pretentious, a bunch of, you know, and that we're, you know, maniac, pretentious maniacs that need to be shouted down. How dare anybody state anything that's beyond their education, you know?" That's their attitude. Or they'll just pass stuff like, "Oh yeah, non-dual, I get, yeah, I know that. There's no I. That's right, yeah." "Yeah, I got it. I got it. Om, Baba Sama, Om, I got it." But so if you really have got it truly and put the massive effort in like I have, then you're just, you know, they just shut you down. Like, you can't have it any better than I do. It's not possible. I know, my I got a diploma. It's bizarre. And so we're in that madness. It's like the inmates are saying, the therapist said, "You don't know anything more than I do. You got no clue. You're the same as I am." And then that can pull the therapist down, right? Or they got to get out of Dodge for a while, take a vacation. I need a vacation from the Bay Area. I need a vacation. Desperately need a vacation from the Bay Area. As I told, you know, I tell the Holy Spirit this, "Holy Spirit, I mean, I don't know what you're doing, but I need a break from this madhouse here. Get out of Dodge and just decompress. My God, what a hive it is here. I'm telling you. Hive mind, hive madness." But, you know, I could wake up in the, you know, I woke up 1:30 in the morning this morning. You know, I started practicing. So I wake up in the middle of the night and just start doing this practice, you know. But still, then you go out and you have these meetings with people that are just, you know, they're passing out all this stuff now, vicious, vicious stuff about, you know, political stuff, you know, aiming, you know, trying to demonize you know who. And and they're talking about openly and loudly in all public places. You know, I mean, it's just the current of extreme counterculture activism here now is brewing, brewing. Hatred is brewing here in the most extreme way, you know, extreme vitriolic hatred and demonization is just, you know, in the air here right now. It's scary. It's very scary because this apex approach, it's dispassion is the whole approach. You're totally dispassionate. You're so dispassionate about whatever arises. You're just passionate about, "I am an apex yogin or yogini." Wow, you're passionate about that. That's the only thing you're passionate about, is that. Nothing else. Nothing else. Okay, that's the key to the practice. Nothing else are you passionate about. Ideally, okay. Ideally. And when you're practicing, you want to practice that way. And I'm pretty much that way now. I'm really dispassionate about the world in just every which way. I really am. But I'm very passionate about, I am an apex yogin. Very passionate about that. World is the opposite. It's passionate about everything except I am an apex yogin. They're not passionate about that at all. They lose sight of that instant, most of them for a lifetime. Just blank out. They're blanked for a whole lifetime. That ain't good, to be blanked for a whole lifetime. That is horrible. I get upset if I'm blank for, like, you know, a minute or 30 seconds. They, you know, spend their entire lifetime blanked on this. And then another one. You know, it's hard to come out of it. If you get so used to being blanked on it, keep telling yourself you're right, it's tough to come out of it. Very tough. There you go, this Apex Yogin shirt. Rocking it. I haven't rocked it out in public though, because people will ask me questions like, "Oh, is that some kind of yoga status? How can I explain it to anybody?" You know, it'll frighten them. Like, "Oh, he knows so much more than me. Oh, that's not right. I got to show him. I'm a highly educated too." Well, don't have the same teachers. I had the Dharma Kings teaching me. Different teachers. Yeah, that's different. Completely different educational system. And, you know, I had a tough time, tough curriculum, very tough curriculum, and still is a tough curriculum, still having a tough time. But you expect it, you know, you don't give up because you realize, oh, this, you know, wow, my bias really is biting me. You get bit by your bias over and over and over, and you get tired of getting bit by it, but you realize it's going to keep biting you until you finally get free of it. But I have to be careful, and because most people still feel, that I'm as smart as him, or I know as much as he does, but that's not really true. It's not really true. It's not really true. And then people say, well, you'd be pretentious, Well, that's not really true either. Again, in the West, we live in this up, especially the United States, our ideal is upper mobility. Okay, that's why we're here. So I've put upper mobility to the greatest possible use. It said, I can take myself from a spiritual moron to, a Dharma prince or an apex yogin. So let me try that. And so I used the opportunity for upper mobility in the United States to do that. But, we shouldn't demonize someone who's successful at this, because then we're all trying to do this. But if we demonize it, that just undercuts our motivation to be upwardly mobile. So we're trying to get out of a heavily stratified culture, society, and see if we can't, being unfettered, if we can't make the most of it. And I've made the most of it. So that should be, praiseworthy. That's the whole idea of being an American. I feel I'm a true American. I'm an ideal American. I made the most of the American experience. That's what it's here for. So we shouldn't be demonizing one another. If we're doing better, they should say, it's all great. That means I can too. People telling me like they had perfect timing. They got out of some place that was really bad. Someone's living in back Santa Cruz Mountains, and they moved just before this winter hit. And they moved to a great place, and they said, it was like the perfect timing. I moved in, it was perfect time. And I told them that too. I said, wow, aren't you fortunate? They said, yeah. And I said, great, I'm so happy for you, because if you can have perfect timing, that means I can have perfect timing too. If you can get out of Dodge just the right time, I can too. Just before this terrible winter in the Santa Cruz Mountains, it's just, and they said, it would have been just hell. So stressful, trying to get to work every day. I can't even imagine what it'd be like, but yet I missed all of that, and I just walked to work, no stress at all. So I'm so happy for them. I told them I'm so happy for them, because that means if they can do it, I can do it too. This is the American attitude. We're supposed to celebrate our success, not demonize it. We've got all these people demonizing success. What is that? It's totally un-American is what it is. I don't demonize it. I say, good for you. You probably worked really hard at it. And that's why you love America. So I gave the opportunity so I could work, and the sky's the limit. Just it depends on how intense and disciplined and intelligent and willing I am to work at it. And so for me, spiritually, I said, if I just give it everything I've got, no one's going to stop me. There's nothing to stop me here. Which is fabulous, It really is, if you use it that way. But so many people haven't used it that way, and they have entitlement complexes to think, I don't want anybody higher than me, because it makes me look bad. It makes me look like I was lazy. And so they think that this is a culture of laziness now, that they don't want anyone succeeding more than they have. That's wicked, It's wicked. It's classism, in the worst way. In the worst way. I want everyone to succeed at Apex Yoga. I want everyone to succeed. I want everyone. That's how I view everyone. I want everyone to be successful. And if you all do it before I do it, I'm thrilled with that too. As long as it doesn't slow me down. But I'm not going to slow down, because it's up to me. So let everyone go super fast. Upward mobility, upward spiritual mobility. What are these people doing excavating at 6:49 on a weekend? Maybe it's like an emergency thing. I don't know. Maybe some, storm drains blocked. I don't know what's going on. This is pretty funny. Let's all in praise of upward mobility. Come on. That's what we come here to America for. And yet there's some folks who want to cap it for everybody. As long as they're on top, at least make sure no one can do better than they did. It's like, hey, And they end up demonizing anyone who's done, really made the most of it. That's all wrong. That's all very, very wrong. They want to be, in charge, central planners, and make sure that nobody can ever get higher than high school. And that's very wrong. That's un-American. So they hate America. There's no doubt about it. They're America haters. That's obvious. And they're lazy. That's also obvious. And again, I remember the Holy Spirit, my whole past started when the Holy Spirit said, well, are you going to do this course or not? And I walked out of this classroom in a dream of A Course in Miracles. And I said, and then some voice came to me out of the sky or somewhere and said, are you leaving? And I said, I don't know. I said, well, what are you doing? I said, it's kind of just, I don't know. I said, well, what, was it too difficult? And I said, no. No, I can do it. It wasn't too difficult. Well, I said, why are you walking away then? You must be lazy. You're lazy, huh? You're lazy? And then I realized the truth cut me to the core. And I said, wow, I was going to choose a lazy life because I was so clever at the, the modern educational system. I was so smart and clever. I could easily have done what most have done, which is just an entitlement complex and just bamboozled everybody with how smart I was. And the Holy Spirit said, well, okay, if you do that, that means you're lazy, plain and simple. And that hit me harder than anything's ever hit me. And I got really very upset with myself. I said, my legacy, here is not going to be that I was lazy. And from that instant, my whole life changed, and it's never have I gone back to being lazy from that instant. I said, no way am I going to face that. When I have to face myself, when I'm moving on, am I going to look at myself and say, you know what? I copped out. I took the lazy way and just used my status and smartness, cleverness to just convince everybody I was entitled. But really, I was just lazy. I said that I couldn't face myself if I did that. I could not face myself. And that was it. It was just decided just like that. My life, just the Holy Spirit just confronted me and said, so you're just going to, you're being lazy then. If it's not too difficult, then you're lazy. You want to be lazy. And I said, oh, you're right. You're right. You got me. You're speaking the truth to me. Thank you. Instantly, my life was changed just like that. No regrets on that. No regrets. Sure, it's been a tough life. And even tougher now that all the lazy people are trying to demonize it, and try to say it doesn't count. Doesn't count. Your life didn't count because you weren't. We can't tolerate it. We can't tolerate it. We want to feel that we're the biggest, baddest people in the room, even though we didn't do the work. This is the trouble I'm up against. Anyone who's done the work, they're up against this trouble. Unless they've got a degree from Cambridge or Oxbridge, as they call it, or something, right? And then people might say, okay, maybe you're a little smarter than me, but I'm almost there. But they still get it all the time. Like, well, I see what you're getting at. Okay, I got it. they can get away with a little bit. They might be able to publish, something. Dalman can get away with a little bit, maybe. But me, no, nothing. No. I didn't have time for Oxbridge. I was going too fast. I got no time for that. And they especially hate religious people because religious people are way brighter than they are. And they didn't, they got an education through generations and generations, maybe hundreds, stretching way back of discipline, spiritual discipline, religious discipline, virtuous habits, studying scripture, wisdom. They have a wisdom culture. And man, those who have the education culture, modern education culture, boy, they hate those who have wisdom culture because they say, you didn't get your degree. What do you, you can't tell me nothing. What do you, you're an ignorant hillbilly. What are you talking about? And they say, no, I know what's right. I know what's right in my heart and what God says is right in my heart. And all the education in the world isn't going to change that one bit. And that just, oil and water, oil and water is what we got going on here. So, hey, God, this, I know it's not your mess, but Holy Spirit, it is your responsibility. Okay. to help those who ask for help. I really feel that way. It's a responsibility. It's got to be the responsibility of grace, or what good is grace if it doesn't help those who ask for help? Really, why wait until we're perfect? That's not help then, right? We're perfect. We don't need help. So it's, of course we're imperfect, but does that disqualify us from being helped if we ask for it? It shouldn't at all. That then help is meaningless. The whole term is meaningless. So we need a whole bunch of help right now. A whole bunch of help. I've had a fabulous education, and we cannot let that go to waste. I've had the whole enchilada, the whole thing. Can't let that go to waste. It's super difficult, super rare right now to at least be able to empathize with all those, you know, modernists, which I can empathize with every one of you out there in the world. I certainly understand and empathize and have compassion with the whole situation. You know, you got a severe problem, very biased against certainty and simplicity, and able to imagine all sorts of complexity, but that doesn't change what we are in the slightest bit. We can meditate a dream of complications as much as we want. Doesn't change the fact reality is still perfectly simple, perfectly uncomplicated. We'll never change it. So, you know, people in the world right now, they got, you know, a severe problem. Just one. A bias against certainty, continuity fear problem, but it's very severe. And it's the same problem for everyone, same solution for everyone. But in looking at this practice, Apex Yoga practice, and knowing what works, now I can also see what doesn't work. And then I can see what kind of habits and attitudes, you know, cause trouble. Cause us to fail in this practice, and which ones help us succeed. And then obviously I can see what kind of culture and society is necessary to help us succeed, and what should be precluded because these habits help us fail at it, at the way out of this trouble, severe problem we have. And so, you know, I can easily tell. And we're not going in the right direction right now. The world is not going in the right direction. They're going in a direction to make themselves miserable failures at this practice. Miserable failures. Which they label success. You know, the label maniacs is thinking that whatever is labeled, that's what it is. You put a label, you know, peanut butter on a bottle of jam, it's still jam. But they say it's peanut butter. They say anybody who says it's not peanut butter is crazy. That's the situation we're in. And what do you say? What do you say to that? Obviously, you say, you know, you got a severe problem, but they don't want to hear it. In the past, you know, for instance, in Christian culture, the message of the church is just people. All of you, you have a severe problem. They call it sin. It's bias against certainty. You all have it, okay? From the king and queen all the way down. And the kings and queens were told in no uncertain terms, you have a very severe problem. You're very severe sinners, okay? Along with everyone else. And they had to bow to the church, and they'd say, you know, and they would go, and they would kneel, and they would go to confession, and they would show that I, too, have a very severe problem. Yes, and we're all equal in that way. The body of Christ is, you know, a body of equal. We realize we're all equal in the fact that we are biased. We have the same problem. We're biased against certainty. And, you know, and we have to repent and recognize this. But you don't see that nowadays, do you? You see that nowadays? These people that have educations, they think that they're, you know, way smarter than that. Say, no, I don't have any severe problem. I graduated from Harvard, you know. How can I have a severe problem? These knuckleheads telling me I have a, you know, sin problem or severe problem just like everyone else. No, are you kidding me? I you know, I got my Harvard degree, and those others who don't, you know, I'm way superior to them. It kind of is a tricky way to try to get around our severe problem without doing anything about it. You know, they just set up this educational system and say, okay, you're a winner. You won. Degree from Harvard, law degree from Harvard, you won. And so you're a winner. And these others, well, they haven't won as much. You know, this is a silly game we're playing. So the church culture, the religious culture is accurate in what they said, that you are all severe sinners. I mean, Calvinism, brought it back to the ultimate extent of, you are all extreme sinners. I mean, they pushed it, they pushed it very severely. I mean, you can talk about Calvinism for another day, but you are all severe sinners. And they said, predestiny, and if without the grace of God, you're going to go to hell. Well, that's pretty accurate, actually. There's more accuracy in that than not, that is for sure. I mean, without the grace of God, we're going to continue to make our bias against certainty even worse. And what is hell but a severe bias against certainty? So in a way, Calvinism, was, in a sort of a crude way, they were accurate. But there's nothing wrong with a crude accuracy. I mean, that can work too. If you're severe sinners, you're predestined to hell, and if without the grace of God, you wouldn't be saved at all from hell. And they brought predestination about the grace of God, which is, they were trying to describe what they saw taking place, and there's some crude accuracy to that in a way. That when you're meant to repent, you will. But if you're not meant to, you won't, so to speak. That's your karma, But when you do repent, boom, suddenly you'll repent and you'll realize, oh yes, I really am a terrible sinner. I have this terrible bias against certainty. And now without the grace of God, there's no way I'm going to get free of this. Which is true. Which is really true. Because our bias precludes us from right spiritual practice. Really, it does. It distracts us away from it. So the Reformation was all these preachers going around the countryside preaching like hellfire and brimstone, right? I mean, you are doomed to eternal torment if you don't repent right now. Now there's a lot of truth to that. So the end is near, which they were right about that too. It's very near. And if you don't repent right now, you are likely to be doomed forever. Well, that part, they got wrong. I mean, that the idea of forever doomed is not true. God, you'll be annihilated. You never, no chance ever again. You missed your chance. You'll never have another one. That's false. But that's actually a concession to their own fear, because the idea of suffering eternal damnation, without any grace, is so scary that they had to say, no, if you miss the boat, you'll be annihilated, and basically you won't have to worry about suffering anymore. That's not true. So it's even worse than what they said. What it is you will be in the hell of bias against certainty until you repent, however long that takes. If it takes, trillions of lifetimes, you'll suffer trillions of lifetimes. Whatever, but it's up to us really to decide, enough's enough. I've had enough of this torture. So they kind of erred based on their own fear of their own damnation. They think, well, maybe I might not make it. Oh, I'd rather be annihilated than suffer, the tortures of hell forever. So they put that false codicil in there, like saying, God's going to annihilate you. Not true. Not true in the slightest bit. That's one part of Christianity that's very false, but they erred based on their own fear, basically, there. No, there's some mistakes that Christianity made because of their own fear. They say, oh my gosh, what if I don't make it? Okay, I hope there's some mercy that God has of annihilating me. And they see that as God's mercy. But no, God never annihilates any idea that God has had. Every idea that God has is eternally in the mind of God and will never be changed or never annihilated. And we're an idea in the mind of God, so... So, yeah, there were some errors in Christianity. And in all religious teachings, there are some errors, actually. Because of the fear of those who are promulgating these teachings gets the better of them, They say, oh my gosh, because they're not so sure they're going to make it, And it's, yeah. We all got some concerns about that. Am I really ever going to get back home? Am I ever going to get free of this bias? But the fire and brimstone stuff was largely accurate. But we think they're all lunatics today. No, they weren't. I mean, they were the most educated, brilliant people of the times, actually, a lot of them. And they had this awakening, you know, like they experienced for themselves, oh my gosh, without the grace of God, I never would have realized what a miserable sinner I am, what miserable bias I have against truth. I would have never even seen it. I was ignorant before I had this experience of repentance. And so they said, you've got to have this experience. Otherwise, you really are doomed to wander like a zombie in a house of madness, which is true. Yeah, doomed until you have this experience. So when they had this inner awakening, you know, many Protestants had this. They said, oh gosh, you know, I got to tell the people about this. And then they did. And it had a tremendous effect, a positive effect on the culture overall. We realized, oh my gosh, you know, I don't realize how severe my bias is, really. They called it sin. I call it, you know, bias against certainty, which is, you know, more accurately descriptive, really. But they were more crude, but it was a rough and ready crude. It's kind of, you know, like country music is beautiful music. Some of it may seem a little crude to our ears, thinking we're so sophisticated. But, you know, there's something about that simplicity of it that is just, it hits home real hard. Real hard. And some of it's, you know, best music I've ever heard. Some country could just be really done gorgeously, tastefully. Used to be done that way. Some of it. But the overall structure of it is not real complex, you know, really. It's just the presentation is done so well. And it's like, that's like some of, and that came from Protestantism and the raw power of their presentation, of how it hit home so strong. Country music came from that, actually. It used to be country gospel, which came from Protestant religious music, which then ultimately turned into country music and then contrapolitan music, and now it's rock and roll pop music, actually, kind of, with, you know, a twang, you know, down by the river kind of stuff. It's kind of just become I don't even know what to say about it. It's lost its roots, let's put it that way. It's lost its gospel roots. It's lost its religious roots. I mean, country music used to have such strong religious roots. You could feel it. You could feel the earnestness and the honesty of these people realizing, hey, I got a severe problem. I ain't right with the Lord, you know, and I know that. And this is bugging the heck out of me. That's why I'm drinking. That's why I'm in this honky-tonk, looking for some honky-tonk woman, you know, to chase my blues away. But, man, it ain't working for me. It really ain't working for me. And I keep thinking this one's going to save me. This you know, the honky-tonk angel's going to save me. But it never works. And neither does the bottle. And I'm in big trouble. And I'm sinking. I'm sinking fast. What am I going to do? So the whole thing is religious. The classic country is religious, very religious music. I love it. I love it. That's what I listen to. And I listen to other stuff too. I like, you know, whatever really has roots in some, like, new wave punk music, you know, is got some raw roots in it too, right? I mean, you can feel it, like I'm desperate, you know, and I know I'm desperate. And I'm messing up, and I know I'm messing up. And I'm not so happy about it. And I'm upset, and I'm honest about it. You know, so punk music was sort of, you know, got away from the pop disco stuff. That, hey, everyone, let's just dance the night away, and it's all good. They're screaming like punks. It's not all good. We're on the road to nowhere. You know, we're on the road to nowhere, and I'm hating it. I'm hating life. I mean, I'm scared. That's, you know, raw punk music, but it didn't have an answer. The problem with punk music, it didn't have any remedy, whereas gospel music, country gospel, it says, where do I go but to the Lord, you know? I've got to get back to God, and I got to get down on my knees, and I got to ask the grace of God for help, ask the Holy Spirit for help. They still had that feeling in it. music these days, it should not even be spoken of, really. Really. I mean, you might be able to find an anomaly somewhere, but that just proves how terrible it is, because it's such an anomaly, right? You can't disprove a cultural norm by pointing out an anomaly. That's just stupidity, right? We're pointing out, cultural norms and how they've changed so much. So anomalies don't have any role in this conversation at all. The people keep thinking, oh yeah, I can think of one band that's good now, so what you say is not true. Well, that just shows you what a miseducation someone has gotten by even thinking that way. Talking about how norms have shifted and how it's normal, we're familiar now with not having roots in what you might say Protestantism, which has roots in, Christianity, strongly rooted in Christianity, and which is strongly rooted in truth, which is universal, which is universal. Jesus came to bring us the truth, the teachings of truth, showcasing him for us, but he's true for everyone. True for there's no other truth than truth. And so it's a constant truth. Truth, the truth is that everything's direct. And that's been realized by traditions all over the world, not just Christianity. It's direct for Hindus, it's direct for everyone, direct for Buddhists, etc. It's always direct. They discovered it too, that it's direct. It wasn't just Jesus that knows it's direct. Many others have discovered this. But he put a particular spin on it, which is helpful for really pagan cultures and societies and self-righteous, stuff. And he put a real interesting, really effective push on it. But there are other ways to push it too. Dzogchen is a way to push it. Pama Sama put a great push on it, to say the least. You talk about converting to heathen. I mean, what a great job he did. What an astonishing job Padmasambhava did. Truly astonishing. But man, I'm telling you, you listen to music, you want to be honest music, and you want it to relate to the fact that you have a severe problem. And we do. When you do this apex yoga practice, you will see the tricks that the mind is playing. You say, oh my God, I've been under the spell of these tricks. Now, I had a dream last night. Very unusual dream, to say the least. I can't hardly even explain it. Like, I was in bed, lying in bed, sleeping, and there was someone there sleeping beside me. And I was sort of, kind of awake. I wasn't totally asleep. And there was this animal, like some kind of deer-like animal or something, that was like, I knew it very well and it knew me, like it was my pet animal or something. And it jumped over the neighbor's fence and was eating the food over there or something. And I said, hey, get away from there. And well, the neighbor's food wasn't good. They painted it all black or something to camouflage it, but it's like junk food or something. I said, what are you doing? Get back over here. You're supposed to be doing that. And it came back to me and was all nice to me and stuff. And I said, what is this dream? What's going on? And then I told the one sleeping next to me, I said, hey, you know this deer? It's very nice, wonderful deer, very friendly. How come you're not paying attention? And they weren't, they said, ah. They're like, how someone's really asleep, seems asleep, and they don't want to pay attention to what you're saying. They kind of go, they don't want to pay attention to what you're talking about. So I couldn't interest them in what was happening in my dream, what was happening to me. I couldn't interest them in it at all. And I said, oh, well, they're sleeping. That's why I'm awake, but they're sleeping. Okay, so I got up in the morning and I'm thinking about this dream, how odd it was, how extraordinary it was. And I was trying to be honest. I said, you know what? I thought that deer was like really spirit, some really spiritual being, but it may have been my bad habits straying back over the fence, where I shouldn't go, through a hole in the fence, or jumping over the fence. I said, you shouldn't be jumping over the fence. That's not right. Going back to the things that I used to do, or something like that. Or I said, something isn't quite right. But then I said, you know what? Suddenly it flashed on me. I said, in that dream, I might be the one who was asleep, and the one that was sleeping next to me might be the one that's actually awake. But I thought they were sleeping, but it really was they weren't paying any attention to my dream. You see that? Completely flipped at 180 degrees. So the one who thought they were awake in the dream was actually asleep, having a dream. And the one that seemed to be asleep was actually awake and not paying any attention to the dream. And so this gets to this apex yoga practice. I see in this practice that the mind is so clever that it tries to flip things in thinking that the one who's dreaming is awake and the one who's not paying attention to the dream is asleep. Completely. So this is now, I'm awakening to this and said, hey, maybe I, the one who thought that they were awake in the dream, is actually the one who's asleep to reality and is having a dream instead of seeing reality. And it might have been that animal, might have been a goat, actually, a goat. And so, you know, goats are notorious for just trying to go around and eat everything. And how I'm saying that now I've changed in my ways, not high school ways anymore. A goat would be high school ways. And they're not settling on what really works. And they're just trying everything. That's a goat. So this goat was jumping over the fence, eating neighbor's food. They said, you shouldn't be over there. Come on back here. I chastise it for that. So that means I'm now changing from a goat to a sheep. A sheep listens to the shepherd saying, do just this, eat just here in this pasture. I've taken you to the right pasture. This is where you're going to eat. And the sheep eat there. Whereas a goat is always looking, you know, to be naughty and go somewhere else. And well, maybe over there is better. Maybe over there is better. And they say at the end times, there'll be a separation between the sheep and the goats. Okay. So in this way of speaking, I understand, you know, what this dream is about. It's showing me that I've changed now from a goat to a sheep, that I suddenly I get it, like this one practice, just settle on that, settle, stay in this pasture, don't be going into other pastures. Apex yoga, rising, you know, in graduating from high school, graduating from being a goat, so I'm not a goat anymore. I realized, the goat is just inherently, it'll keep straying over to other stuff. I said, stay right here, and it wouldn't stay right there. I told it, come on, don't go over there. It kept misbehaving, and you know, not doing what I said, not listening. So I said, wow, that's not good. I don't want to be a goat and keep on jumping fences here and there. Let me just focus on what's going to awaken me for sure here. Stop shopping around. It's like getting married. You commit. When you get married, you stop shopping around. And if you don't, you know, your wife or your spouse will tell you about it. Especially your wife will tell you about it, right? Says, hey, you know, no more shopping around. So you commit, and things go more smoothly then, and you're able to really focus in. So what an extraordinary dream, and recognition during the day then, like, wait a minute, who was really asleep? That one that I thought was asleep was probably fully awake, and they're just saying, I'm not paying attention to the, you're dreaming, I'm not paying attention to your dream at all, I'm not interested in it, I'm not interested at all. And I took that, their lack of interest, I took for sleep, I thought they were sleeping. So I had it completely backwards. So there's a great example of catching a super important mistake and owning it and saying, wow, how interesting, how amazing is this, huh? So I have to thank all the great Protestant preachers. Their fire and brimstone came down to me somehow and was able to be super beneficial to me. Along with, you know, the great Catholic, great Christian, early Christian preachers, their fire and brimstone too. It was just the middle-aged church, Catholic church, just really got away from it all, you know, saying, don't worry, we'll just sell you indulgences, send all your money to Rome, and you're good. Yeah, and the real Christians said, whoa, 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 whoa. This isn't doing us any good at all. We need to reform this. And that became the Reformation. So thank God for the Reformation. Not to put Catholicism down throughout history. It's done a great job in the big picture, but it really got off track badly. And, you know, it ran out of steam, kind of. And then the Reformation came along and said, you know, full fire and brimstone, folks. And a lot of people got helped by that, a lot. And it's because they were helped that passed down to their children, generation by generation got passed down, and then it reached me. And I said, huh, what are these people screaming about hell? And I was like puzzled by it. I was like, they seem to be very intelligent, good people. I can't really dismiss them. And yet the education I got was like, no, no, we're all fine. We don't have any severe problem. What are they talking about? Sin. What are they talking about? We're told you're not sinners. No, that's all some religious myth. You know, we don't have any severe problem. We need to be well educated. And as soon as we're well educated, we don't have any more problem. That's the whole liberal modernism. Is our only problem is education, a lack of education. As soon as we get a good humanistic education, we're good. That's the whole premise of modern humanism. And they couldn't be more mistaken if they tried. They couldn't be more mistaken. Totally overlook the entire syndrome that we have of insanely severe bias against certainty, because we're trying to doubt what we are, doubt reality, which is total certainty. And so we've had to then take massive effort to brainwash ourselves into doubt. So this creates an enormous familiarity with doubt and bias against certainty. And that isn't even touched upon in the modern humanistic education. Not even touched upon in any which way. They just say, no, just go to school, get, you know, show that you're good, clever at thinking, you know, sort of genius sort of thing of arithmetic, and get good SAT scores, and you're good. And anyone who says you're not is a liar and a deceiver and a you know, mentally ill. That's their favorite phrase. You know, you're mentally ill if you disagree with them. Yeah, but their premise is completely false. So they're the ones who are mentally ill, actually. I don't like calling them that. They just have a severe bias against certainty. But they're refusing, you know, to admit this. So, you know, they have not yet repented, and they're going to continue to wander in the fires of hell, fires of doubt. Unfortunately, they most certainly will. There's no doubt about it. I was a super good person, yet I was wandering in the fires of hell horribly. I was a super kind, compassionate, nice, intelligent person, but I had this terrible bias against certainty, and, you know, it was caused severe problems. And they will not miss out on those problems. They know it deep down, they know it, and they think they can just project their problems on others and scapegoat others. They'll miss out on it, but no, they won't. It'll only make it worse. It'll only make it worse, actually. So you can either take your medicine now or take it later, but later it's going to taste even more bitter. That's a fact. So those great Protestant Reformation preachers, you know, thank you all, thank God, I've left you out of, you know, our thanks, but now I see you are included in that. You absolutely are included in that. The Great Awakening, and people awakening say, oh my gosh, what were we thinking? That we could buy our way out of bias? You know, just give money to somebody who said that they represented God, and now you give them money, and they say, oh, okay, it's good with God. God's happy now. You gave me money, and, you know, it's the church. The church said, you give us money, we'll talk to God, make it all right. We're God's accountants, and so we know how God does his accounting, and you know, buy indulgences, et cetera, sell your money to Rome. We'll just cook the books, and God won't know any better because we're such great accountants. God won't even know. You know, very shrewd accountants. A lot of accountants are crooks, actually. So they basically got so much hubris that they felt that they could, you know, somehow cook the books, and they'd say, don't worry, God won't even know, you know. Yeah, well, how wrong they are, how wrong they are. That's just casting more doubt upon God. There's no accounting in God at all. There's no accounting books at all. So you can't even, there's nothing to cook. You can't cook the books. There's no judgment upon us at all from God. We're an idea in the mind of God, and therefore we're perfect forever. It's that simple. Nothing else more to it than that. So there are no books to cook. No indulgences to buy at all. None. No sacrifices need to be made. None. Okay, that's all fear-based nonsense. But if we don't work on overcoming this, but let the grace of God help us overcome this bias against certainty, we're going to keep wandering in this swamp, this hellish swamp of doubt, without a doubt. Without a doubt, we will continue that. Man, I wasn't spared it at all. I said, God, I'm so good. I'm going to really help you out. Spare me. God says, what could I do? You're perfect. And you have a bias against that fact. And I can't, there's no books I can cook. You have to overcome the bias. So here's the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will tell you what to do. And just do what the Holy Spirit tells you to do. That's all. I said, yeah, but it's difficult. God says, hey, well, yeah, I mean, I can understand how it would be difficult. But you have to do it anyway. You have to do it anyway. There's no bargains to be made. There's no bargains to be made. You got to do it. So maybe I'm a modern, fire and brimstone preacher type. With, I try to be more sophisticated and more on point. But it pretty much amounts to the same thing, doesn't it? I'm more aware of what grace is skillful means, that the grace of God has given us, mantra yoga, I'm more aware of that. And, they had their own ways, fervent, bhakti yoga, fervent prayer to God, various ways of prayer and repentance and atonement, they had their ways but mantra yoga is supreme. Mantra yoga is supreme. There's no doubt about it. I mean, you can absolutely be liberated quickly from your doubts. Be liberated from your doubts. Because you see them dissolve, they just dissolve. They're gone. They just dissolve. And you get familiar with them dissolving, and you realize, they were just total imagination. I made it all up. Just mere label, as Longchenpa puts it. Mere label. That's all it is. It's mere label. And he says, don't ever make the egregious mistake of that mere label is fact. That's like the egregious mistake we're making. All this dream of doubt is just a play of label with, like I said, putting a peanut butter on a jar of jelly and saying it's peanut butter. Ridiculous, isn't it? But yet we're so familiar with it. We keep thinking we've been eating peanut butter. No, we're still eating jam or marmalade. I got some marmalade today. I got some peanut butter and marmalade, actually, which I can't really eat because I'm gaining too much weight. It's ridiculous. I just eat a normal diet. I gain a pound a day. If I eat lunch, I gained a pound. It's crazy. I got to starve myself. It's not pleasant. I mean, I like eating like anyone else, Can't even eat here. Just gotta blend up some kale. Yeah, that's about it. I don't even know what I'm gonna eat tonight. I don't know. I got some cauliflower, some butter squash. I don't know. Something that doesn't have calories. That's for sure. I'm right at the edge of my top weight now. I'm starting to feel fat, It's like, I can feel it. I feel filled out, It's a good, you feel strong when you're filled out, a little bulkier. You feel a little more bulky. But if not stop, that'll just won't stop. It'll just keep going. If I eat just a normal diet that most people would eat, even by half of what normal people eat, I just gain weight super fast. So, because it just doesn't burn. I don't burn calories. Even if I work out, I don't burn calories. It's really quite bizarre. Slow metabolism. Which is ideal for spiritual path, actually. Very ideal. Because I really don't feel, I don't get this feeling like action. I got to do stuff. I get this feeling like sitting here quietly is perfectly fine. And I don't get hungry. I don't I gotta go eat. I could just, I don't feel that way. I can sit here for all day and not feel like I need to do anything. I could just have one meal and that's good for an entire day. If it's large enough meal, I could just forget it. Or 2 days even. So it's easy for me to not feel like I need to do something. I don't make up, excuses like, because I have so much energy. I need to do this. I need to do this. I need this. These people with a lot of energy, they're always doing this, this, this. Me, I'm perfectly happy not to do anything. Doesn't bother me at all. I could just let everything be exactly as it is and not do anything and feel perfectly fine with that. I don't feel like I need to fix anything. I don't feel any desire rising me. I gotta fix something. No. And of course, nothing needs to be fixed, actually. Everything is perfectly direct, straight from spirit, right this instant. Everything is perfect this instant, perfectly direct. Directly now. There's no time, space, process, or form involved in what's taking place at all, ever. It's never happened. Not even a fragment of it, not even a tiny speck of time, space, process, or form has ever happened at all. Not even a tiniest speck has ever happened. Everything has been seamlessly direct. Seamlessly direct. So take all this to heart, with your determination, with your repentant attitude. Take it with a repentant attitude. Not dry intellect, nor wet intellect, emotionalism, No, take it in a repentant attitude. Mood of repentance is, you have to hear everything in the mood of repentance. That's absolutely essential. Otherwise, it's just in one ear, out the other. So this has to really grip you, and you feel like, wow. This, listen to someone preach here, modern preacher, and you got to repent, It's a very serious thing. Can't be lazy. Repentance is the end of your laziness. Entitlement complex is the end of entitlement complex. Yeah, then you're upwardly mobile. Ultimately, you're legitimately entitled, but that's not an entitlement complex. It's legitimate entitlement from authority, from, doing all the work. That's apples and oranges, compared to not doing the work and then claiming you should be entitled to the same authority of one who has done it, and who has done the work. That's called an entitlement complex. Which, from my experiencing, that's what the educational system teaches you here, is how to develop an entitlement complex. And I didn't want any part of that. I actually flunked classes on purpose. I just said, give me an F. I don't want an entitlement complex. I don't want to do it. I want to do it. You're just teaching me how to be wicked, and to feel okay about it, smugly okay about it. That's wickedness, I'm going to pay the price for that at some point. So you may not reap the rewards of good habits immediately, but down the road you will. This has been my experience. Down the road, they definitely, it's like you fertilize your tree, fruit tree. You get a new fruit tree, maybe a couple years, you don't get any fruit. But then, down the road when they start really fruiting heavily, you look at it and the whole tree's full of great fruit because you watered, you fertilized, you weeded, you pruned, you did everything. You had all these good habits, hopeful that they would pay off down the road. And now you have this abundant fruit because you did the right stuff and you didn't go for instant gratification of our instant gratification society. I've had to forego gratification. I'm suffering all the time, but I say, it's going to pay off. It's going to pay off. And what a payoff that is. Wow, I'm an invincible apex yogin. I'm an invincible apex yogin. Wow. I am an invincible apex yogin. Wow. Now that's the fruit of the spirit. So all thanks to all the generations throughout history that have, not been lazy, spiritually lazy, and realize, listen with a repentant attitude and realize they have a severe bias against certainty. They admit it. They're humble. They realized I'm out of sorts with God in terms of my own belief, and that has to change. That has to be changed. Otherwise, I can't get into the kingdom of heaven, meaning I can't experience reality as it really is. I won't be able to. That's exactly right, because we'll be doubting it. And we'll think it's crazy. And we'll think that we're the ones that are awake and the ones that are paying no attention to our stupid dream are asleep. And we need to, pull them into our dream. We'll make that terrible mistake. In the meantime, I need a magic carpet ride out of the Bay Area. Really, it's becoming toxic here. Very toxic place for, genuine repentant mindset. Genuine repentant mindset. Where you look at your brothers and sisters, I just use the one term, brothers in Christ, is, hey, we all have a very severe problem. Does the president have a severe problem? Absolutely. Does he need to repent? Absolutely. Do I have a severe problem? Absolutely. Do you have a severe problem? Absolutely. We're all in the same boat that way, okay? So let's start, with that. And let's not start pulling some, I'm high and mighty, act on everybody, as far as demonizing those who don't agree with us or whatever. Let's focus on our own repentance here, and not focus on scapegoating. Doesn't mean you agree with policy this or that, but it means that you are focused on your repentance, and it's a whole different story. And then nobody's going to stop me. Once you repent, you realize no one can stop me. I've got the grace of God working with me now to help me overcome my bias against certainty, to help me get into the kingdom of heaven, which means experiencing reality as it actually is, instead of trying to impose, a false picture upon reality. So forget about scapegoating people. Realize, yeah, they have a bias. Yeah, they're a sinner. Yeah, and so am I, and so are you, and so is everybody. So let's all pray together. Let's all pray for the grace of God to enlighten us and lead us properly. And let's show love to one another. Because, if your goal is to make a Hitler out of someone and scape so you can scapegoat him, that's what you're going to end up with. That's a fact. Very convenient scapegoat, Hitler, right? Very convenient scapegoat. We're perfect, and all our problems are because of Hitler, right? He's the reason why we're, So, if you want to, if you're determined to cultivate someone to be like that, you might end up with that. On the other hand, you can say, I don't need it. I don't need a scapegoat. And guess what? You won't end up with some maniac then. Total flip the whole script. Then you approach them and say, you know what? I got a severe problem, and I know that I'm out of sorts with God, and I'm not going to pull a high and mighty trip on you, a hate trip on you. I know that you got your issues too, and let's pray together. Let's bow our heads together. Let's bow our heads together. You go to church, you bow your heads together. Meaning, I'm here with everyone else, and we're all out of whack with reality. We're doubting the perfection of God here. So let not me be the one who, claims my degree from Harvard or somewhere is, I don't need to bow my head before God, Let me not pull that mischief, Let's all bow our heads and pray for the merciful grace of God to be upon us and upon the land. And let us pray that the merciful grace of God inspires our leaders to, wisely shepherd the province of the federal government, in this country. That's, well, when we go to church, that's what the priest says. All right? They don't rip into people. They say, let us all pray for the president, that the grace of God be upon him. And he makes wise and just decisions according to the grace of God, so that we all may, benefit from this. Pray for the leaders. Pray for them. Pray for the wisdom of the Holy Spirit descends upon them instead of screaming that they're Hitler. I mean, Jesus Christ Almighty, what is this, country and world coming to? Ignorance is what it's coming to. So send love and compassion and heart and say, may the love of Christ Jesus be upon you. The love of, may the the grace of the Dharma Kings be upon you. May the grace of Dharma Kings be upon us all. And who are we to, you know what, you know, policy is the best for religious practice unless we're really tuned into it, experientially tuned into it. Let the Dharma Kings, you know, tell us what is best for our culture. Because I'll tell you right now, the way that's been going for quite some time is extremely bad for our culture. It seems blatantly that way. So we have to turn some stuff around. And they don't want to turn anything around, the people. They say, no, we're not making any mistakes. It's going exactly the way we think it should go. And they don't want to admit that anything needs to be turned around. So it's a, you know, just a bizarre situation here, really bizarre. That publicly, everyone should pray. Publicly, everyone bow their heads together and ask, let the grace of God descend upon this country, which is torn by strife right now, and let us all together recognize our bias against certainty and work together on it and be supportive of one another and realize that some will do better than others at this, and then let's listen to them with humility. Let's all have humility together. And a good population gets a good leadership, you know. A humble population gets wise leadership. So at some point you have to stop this scapegoat train. You know, it's a train to hell is what it is. It's really a train to hell. And, you know, you can take good people and turn them into tyrants if that's what you're determined to do. That's a fact. You can get very strong, decisive people, and if you're determined to turn them into a tyrant so you can scapegoat them, that's probably what you're going to get. So you can say, you see, I was right all along. I knew there would be a Hitler, you know? And we were completely right, they were completely wrong, and so there's nothing we need to work on. Unfortunately, that's the negative spiral of history that we're into right now. That secular humanism has put us into this hideous spiral of history right now. Now, do we have a problematic situation? I say, certainly. Can it be made worse? It can be made a lot worse. Can it be made better? It can be made a lot better if everyone prays together, starting with themselves, you know? Starting with themselves and admit to, you know, accept the fact that they need the grace of God in their lives. And that there's some who have done this, and they would be well wise to start paying attention and taking the advice and repent before it's too late, because there's certainly an Armageddon like scenario coming upon this world. There certainly is. That I've been warned about so many times, it's not even worth repeating it. You know, it's just a great scapegoating situation, so we don't spend our time overcoming our bias, we're going to suffer some sort of catastrophe, so we can say, oh, you see, if it weren't for the catastrophe, everything would have been fine. You know, that kind of thing. It's like a cosmic scapegoat. You know, go too far down the road of scapegoating, you end up pulling in a cosmic scapegoat. So you can just say, that was the problem, not me. Not my bias against certainty, but, you know, some unfortunate catastrophe befell the world, and unavoidable. It was unavoidable. You know, rub of the green, whatever we could do, but nothing wrong with us. You know, we're fine. We didn't have any bias. This is what happens. And that can be turned around too. Like Jonah and Nineveh telling the Ninevites, saying, listen, you're so into scapegoating and wickedness, you're gonna pull destruction down upon yourselves. It's not God's destruction, really. It's your own wickedness that's going to destroy you. But if you repent, get down on your knees and repent to God and say you have a bias against certainty, you will be spared that destruction, because you won't call it upon yourself anymore. And supposedly the whole city, the greatest city in ancient times, repented and was spared terrible destruction. I don't know how long that repentance lasted, but the principle is there. Principle is there. Jonah delivered the message, they listened to him, they repented, and this is part of the message of the Old Testament of saying, you know, this is a dynamic you need to pay attention to. I mean, the Old Testament isn't wrong about everything. It's got a lot of biases in it and mistakes, but there's also a lot of wisdom in it too. Jesus just tried to clean up the mistakes. And we're still trying to clean them up. And not many are listening. They say, I don't need to listen. You know, I got my degree. My degree in no need to listen anymore. I have a degree in non-listening. I have a degree in non-repentance, really. That's really what happens. You get a degree, if you think, I don't have to repent. I've got my pot, why do I need to repent? Yeah. Got my pot, got my dog. It's all good. Until it isn't anymore. A lot of hard-headed folks in this world right now, to say the least. I mean, I'd do fire and brimstone. I feel like I'd be a fire and brimstone preacher, but I don't think that would work. They just lock you up in a loony bin, you know, and say you're completely demented. So, you know, I do it this way, which is more tame to the sensibilities of the modern world. But boy, a fire and brimstone preacher would be pretty nice, wouldn't it, at this time? But we're just not getting them. People say, oh, that's so archaic, you know, it's so ignorant. No, it's not. It's actually very accurate. It's just a little rough around the edges. You know, you got a fiddle and a bass. If you got a fiddle and a, you know, someone clanking away on the piano, you know, some crude country music, but, you know, it still has a great message to it, doesn't it? It still sounds great. But people would just be freak out if I did fire and brimstone. They'd just completely freak out. You know, it would just like, they would think that's like worse than, you know, the destruction of the world. They would think that's the destruction of the world. Oh my God, but where did we go wrong? You know, how could this happen? We thought you were so educated. Our education system failed you. What happened? Oh my God, well, maybe you just, you know, education can't fail. It must be you have some, you know, brain tumor or something. Well, don't worry, we'll find out what it is. They'll give you a whole bunch of tests. We'll find out. We'll give you the right medication for it. Don't worry. Our educational system didn't fail. It didn't fail. You know, it's like that. That's their God. The educational system's their God. No, my gosh. Thank God for Jesus Christ and Padmasambhava, huh? And all the Dharma kings. Otherwise, we would be too far gone, really. Too far gone. So, it's all direct. It's all direct. It's all direct. It's all direct. Always has been, always will be. And to the extent that we don't accept this, we're severely deluded. Even if we don't accept it a tiny bit, we're severely deluded. To say a tiny bit is not direct is to say that God is not God. Same as to say it's all not direct. It's the same. Same lie, you know, same doubt. To say a little bit of doubt about perfection is different than a lot of doubt is really the big lie. That's the biggest lie. It's trying to hide the lie by contrasting doubt, you see. And we think we're super clever by doing that. But we're just super arrogant by doing that. All right, apex yoga, apex yoga, apex yoga. Just say, I am an apex yogin, or I am an apex yogini. And just say that, just nothing other than that. Just get, wow, get used to it. I am an apex yogin, wow. I am apex yogini, wow, 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 wow. And just say that, and you will feel like something different is in you, something different is in you. Because you're stating the reality of what you really are. You know? And by stating it, you are that yogin, right? You are practicing. And suddenly you're practicing now, which is the activity of repentance. Your professors aren't telling you to say that, are they? Yeah, I don't know. Which, are they really saying that? Tell you just do just that and nothing else. Nothing else. What professors are saying that at Harvard? Nothing else. Just say this. Padmasambhava is saying this. The Dharma kings are saying this. Longchenpa is saying this. Okay? Absolutely. Just say this and not do this and nothing else. You need to do nothing else. Just try that. Just try that. Just try that. As soon as you do that, you're an apex yogin or an apex yogini. Just as soon as you do that, you realize, oh my gosh, I really am that. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. And how long have I been taping this? I don't know. What time is it? I lost track of time. I'm having so much fun. This is Apex Yoga. Apex Yoga. Yeah, Apex Yoga in the house. Apex Yoga in the house. Apex Yoga in the house. I don't know if you can see that. Yeah, Apex Yoga in the house. 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 Enjoy, enjoy, enjoy your path. Enjoy your path. Love your path. Love your path. Love your path. Okay. I try to bring a love of the path here. I love my path. I love it. It's just that 1% of my future. What is going, well, it's got to smooth out, doesn't it? I just have to say it will smooth out because I am an invincible apex yogin. So that's all there is to it. That's all there is to my future is I am an invincible apex yogin right now. And so that can't change because there is no future. It's only now. There's only directness. So how can there be a future? Only can be a future if reality isn't totally direct right now. That some of it's not direct and has delayed to the future, right? Since everything is totally direct, there can't possibly be this so-called future at all. So I'm an invincible apex yogin right now, right now. All power to the now. All power to the now. There is no other power. It's all power to the now. All direct. Everything's direct. It's all direct, 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 direct. Wow. Okay, love your path. Love everyone. Pray for everyone's well-being. Don't be a hater. Okay, be a prayer. Just say, I pray for, don't say what you th the outcome should be. Just say, I pray that the grace of God descends upon everyone. And then let it be, right? Because the grace of God knows better than we do what each one's role is in salvation. I mean, the leaders of the federal government has a different role than they have to administer all these bureaucracies and agencies and all this kind of stuff that has to make these decisions to do this. I mean, it's a different role, okay? So they're going to seem to be different than we are, but the grace of God can descend upon them too, and make them make the right decisions, right? Yeah. So just pray the grace of God descends upon everyone here, and then follow what the grace of God tells you to do in terms of right spiritual practice, right spiritual practice, which ultimately is apex yoga, is stating the truth of your being and paying no attention to all the doubts that arise. This helps free us from doubt, which overcomes our bias towards certainty, which then liberates us into the so-called kingdom of heaven, which has always been present. It's just, again, we've been throwing a picture of doubt up in our minds about it. All sorts of cleverness. Simple, simple. But repentant mind can gather. The mood of repentance can see this. Oh, I see it. Yeah. It's doable. It's doable. It's doable. It's doable. I can do that. Alrighty. Very great. Got to stop at some point here, I guess. That's it for this one.